Dear students, in this module titled Contents of Population Studies and Type of Data Required for the Study, we will be focusing on the major learning objectives like definitions of demography and population studies, components of population growth, the demographic research both quantitative and qualitative, and the data required for quantitative and qualitative research. Let's discuss about in the beginning about how the emergence of population studies as a discipline has come. After the Second World War, two important but welcome changes have taken place in the world. One was the unprecedented decline in the death rates in several developing countries, and another was attainment of freedom by several Asian, African, and Latin American countries from colonial rule. With political independence, there were hopes and aspirations for eradication of poverty, raising the standards of living of the masses, and improving the quality of life of the people. A new era of planning for development dawned, and many countries chose the path of planned development and adopted time-bound national development plans for the attainment of social and economic betterment of their people. This realization also gave rise to the curiosity of the academicians and planners, policy makers and administrators to know more about the population and its dynamics. Efforts were made to search for the available information and to create scientific database on the subject so that the study of population becomes a scientific discipline. As part of the efforts to improve the national population data, the United Nations, along with many developing countries, conducted population census around 1950s onwards. Thus, the scientific study of population started taking shape and since then has made tremendous progress. Let's discuss about the discipline of the study of human population, which is usually coined with two terms, population studies and demography. While population studies obviously is understood as studies concerning population, the term demography is derived from the Greek word demos, meaning people, and hence population studies, demography is the science of population. Demography in the broad sense includes, in addition to the quantitative study of population, the study of interrelationship between population and social, economical, cultural and other variables. However, many scholars use the term population studies and demography interchangeably. Though a number of researchers and social scientists have defined population studies in their own way, in general, you may understand it as an empirical, statistical, and mathematical study of human populations. Warren S. Thompson, 1958, described population studies as being concerned with the following questions related to broad areas of study. What are the changes that are taking place in the size of the population, and how are these changes brought about? What is the significance of these changes from the standpoint of human welfare? Where are people found, and what are the changes taking place in their distribution in communities? What kind of people are found in any given population group, and how do those in one group differ from those in the other? This clearly indicates that the study of population is concerned with the size or number of population and the changes that are taking place in the size or number of population. Let's devote on aspects of population structure and population characteristics. Before proceeding further, it would be useful to understand the difference between population structure and population characteristics. Although in demography in general, population structure and population characteristics are often used interchangeably to describe the distribution of characteristics such as age, sex, marital status, occupation, etc. However, in a more restricted sense, population structure implies composition or distribution of the population according to age and sex only. On the other hand, population characteristics means composition of population by characteristics such as religion, caste, ethnicity, occupation, education, etc., or any other socio-economic characteristics. Population characteristics too can change through the changes in social mobility. For example, movement of population from single status to married. Thus, it is clear that the subject matter of population studies includes the study of fertility, mortality, and migration and social mobility, that is, the components of change in the size, structure, characteristics, and the distribution of population and the changes occurring in them. Let's discuss about the scope of population studies. The scope of population studies is quite wide. In fact, for the study of population, one has to primarily depend on two quantitative sciences, namely mathematics and statistics. Numbers is an important tool in the study of population. The population scientists have to handle numbers when they are analyzing the size of population, its growth during a specific period, the components of population growth, the distribution of population, the structure and characteristics of population, etc. However, when they embark on the analysis of various socio-economic and political factors affecting different aspects of population phenomena, the population scientists have to go beyond numbers and seek explanations. Thus, a student of population is more involved in describing and comparing the size, structure, characteristics, and the territorial distribution of the population and the changes occurring in it through the study of fertility, mortality, migration, and social mobility. He or she also attempts to explain population phenomena and situations and the changes in them in the context of biological, social, economic, and other settings. Since population phenomena take place in a social setting and cannot be studied in isolation, hence, while describing, comparing, or explaining the determinants and consequences of population phenomena, social phenomena have also to be taken into consideration. You should be clear that the study of population is a multidisciplinary in nature. It involves an understanding of various disciplines like biology, genetics, mathematics, statistics, economics, sociology, cultural anthropology, psychology, political science, geography, medicine, public health, ecology, and so many such disciplines. Let's discuss about what are the various components of population growth. The major components of population growth are birth rate, death rate, and migration. Birth rate is the number of live births per 1000 births population in a year. It is a major component of growth. Death rate is the number of deaths per 1000 persons in a year, and migration is the movement of people across regions and territories. It needs to be specified here that the population of any area may change as a result of the changes in either one or more components of the population growth, and these could be like births may occur in the population, some of the inhabitants of the area may die, some of the inhabitants of the area may move out, people from other areas may move into the area. The study of population is also concerned with the structure and characteristics. This aspect of population studies is devoted to the study of basic personal, social and economic characteristics or attributes of any population, such as age, sex, race, nationality, religion, language, marital status, literacy, educational composition, occupation, etc. For example, what are the proportional distributions of males and females in Kerala and Uttar Pradesh in 2001? It can be mentioned that the percentage of males and females in Kerala in 2001 were 48.58 and 51.42 respectively, and those in Uttar Pradesh were 52.67 for males and 47.33 for females, clearly indicating a numerical surplus of women in Kerala and a deficit of women in Uttar Pradesh. To take another example, the percentage of literate women in India was 0.6 in the beginning of the 20th century, that is in 1901, which has risen to over 54% by the end of the century. Let's talk about the nature of demographic research that exists in the field. Research in common practice refers to search for knowledge in a scientific and systematic way. The Encyclopedia of Social Sciences defines research as the manipulation of things, concepts or symbols for the purpose of generalizing to extend, correct or verify knowledge, which aids in the construction of theory. Research is thus an original contribution towards advancement of the existing stock of knowledge. Research being a scientific activity, knowledge in its context refers to facts obtained with the help of observation, analysis and interpretation. Demographics is study of a population based on factors such as age, race and sex, among others. Governments, corporations and non-governmental organizations use demographics to learn more about a population's characteristics for many purposes, including for policy development. Let's understand about the research process. The research process in demography or in any other field consists of a series of actions or steps necessary to effectively carry out research and the desired sequencing of these steps. The various steps involved in a research process are neither mutually exclusive nor are they separate and distinct. They do necessarily follow each other in any specific order, and the researcher has to be constantly anticipating at each step in the research process the requirements of the subsequent steps. Let's understand what are the major steps in research process. The following order concerning the various steps provides a useful procedural guidelines regarding the research process, which can be classified into three major phases. At a conceptual phase, we need to formulate research problem, conduct literature review, and develop the hypothesis. In the empirical phase, preparing a research design, determining the sample design and collecting the necessary required data. And at the third stage, that is analytical phase, analysis of data, hypothesis testing, generalization and interpretation, and preparation of the report, presentation of the results, that is the formal write-up of the conclusions reached, are very, very important in the research process. The conceptual phase of the research process isolates and articulates a problem of scientific relevance. The empirical phase consolidates the related ideas and theories leading to facts, and the analytical phase compares these facts with the initial understanding of a phenomena. Let us discuss in detail. Formulation of the research problem. This is the first step in the conceptual phase in the formulation of the research problem, that is formulation of a general topic into a specific research problem. The researcher must single out the problem that he or she wants to study. For instance, in the field of population studies, researcher A might be interested in studying the factors responsible for population change. From a broad field of population change, it can be further specified as factors affecting population growth. Further still, a specific factor may be considered, say fertility, then the research problem may be formulated as effect of fertility decline on population. A good research problem should be clear and unambiguous and state the relationship between two or more phenomena. There are two types of research problems, that is those which relate to the state of nature and those which relate to the relationships between phenomena. Therefore, understanding the problem thoroughly and rephrasing the same into meaningful terms from an analytical point of view is important. The statement of the objectives determines the data which are to be collected, the characteristics of the data that are relevant, and relationships which are to be explored, the choice of techniques to be used, and the form of final report. If there are certain pertinent terms, the same should be explained along with the problem. Let us devote more time to discuss about what are the differences in quantitative and qualitative research methods. Qualitative research is a type of formative research that includes specialized techniques for obtaining in-depth responses about what people think and how they feel. They provide a depth of understanding and deal with the emotional and contextual aspects of human responses rather than the objective and measurable aspects. Qualitative methods provide rich data about real life people and situations, and being more able to make sense of behavior and to understand behavior within its wider context. Qualitative research techniques hence involves the identification and exploration of a number of often related variables that give us insight into the nature and causes of certain issues or problems and into the consequences of the problems for those affected. Qualitative research methods involve participant observation, unstructured interviewing, case studies, focus groups, etc. The qualitative research is often conducted to answer the questions why rather than what. However, qualitative research is often criticized for lacking generalizability, being too reliant on the subjective interpretations of the researchers, and being incapable of replication by subsequent researchers. Within demography, qualitative approaches have tended to focus on certain topics, particularly those that are considered sensitive. Of course, the choice of method is dependent on whether it is the best approach to answering a question, and within demography, qualitative approaches have tended to be used in the study of family and partnership dynamics, fertility and family planning, and lifestyle, life stage transitions, etc., the transition to adulthood. Furthermore, there is a plethora of qualitative research around prescribed behavior such as unsanctioned sexual activity, illegal, illicit, and undesirable behavior. These issues tend to be poorly captured by surveys, and where data on attitude and actual behavior is needed, especially for guiding subsequent interventions. The problems posed by HIV or AIDS research and interventions have driven much of the movement towards qualitative research methods. Within demography, qualitative approaches incorporate a richness of information that cannot be captured using only quantitative data. As such, qualitative methods have increasingly drawn the attention of demographers and led to the emergence or recognition of a new field, the demographers, and led to the new field like anthropological demography. In demography, the most frequently used qualitative methods are focus group discussions, in-depth individual semi-structured interviews, and life histories. The main characteristics of qualitative research are: it asks why, how, and under what circumstances things occur. It seeks the depth of understanding. It views social phenomena holistically, and it explores and discovers. It provides insights into the meaning of decisions and actions. It uses interpretive and open-ended methods. It involves respondents as active participants rather than subjects. It defines the investigator as an instrument in the research process. It minimally disrupts the setting and group being studied. There are different distinctions that exist between qualitative and quantitative research, which are very essential for us to know about, and so that we'll be very clear in what context we have to use, whether it is a qualitative methods or it is to be used quantitative methods. To that extent, we have to focus, and also wherever possible, mixed methods of combining both quantitative and qualitative are also important. A skillful use of different techniques of data collection can maximize the quality of data and reduce the chances of bias. Depending upon the purpose of the study, it's recommended to combine the two types of techniques rather than using them in isolation. And in that way, when we talk about the population, besides the number and in terms of the rates, ratios, and various proportions, it is also very important for us to understand the societal aspects, the various socio-economic, cultural, demographical, health, and other various dimensions that are contributing for the situations in terms of the fertility, the mortality, and migration. And in that context, the subjects of population studies are very important, and this very growing field, and also being it's a multidisciplinary, we need to understand the various other disciplinary focuses when we analyze the population data. In this context, the population characteristics at the first stage, we need to know the extent of the population and the extent and the rate in which the population figures are changing, but at the same time, we also should emphasize about the factors that contribute for the such changes, the way in which the differences exist, the differentials are to be incorporated, and also the determinants that exist for understanding such behavior in the vital events like fertility, mortality, nuptiality, and migration, and all these factors are very, very important. In the context of developing countries like India, where the diversity of population is very important for us, is that we need to adopt wherever possible both qualitative and quantitative techniques, so that very comprehensive way of understanding the situations and a thorough way of working out the suitable programs and schemes in addressing those issues related to the people is very important, so that we can see that the programs are effectively carried out, and to see that maximum benefit arise and contributes for the people for whom these programs are meant for. And in that context, the discipline demography or population studies is a very important growing, and such a multidisciplinary focus will enlarge our understanding and provides a vital base for planning and also evolving suitable policies, programs, and schemes, so that the people's quality of life can be enhanced. And in that way, this it is an important growing field, and not only applicable in a particular area, but also within, not only in the country as a whole, but also internationally, for comparing across different countries to understand the levels of development, and also to understand the various population characteristics are much more meaningful in that context. And in this way, the study of population, which is very important on a scientific lines, not only to understand the population in terms of numbers, its structure, its characteristics, and the various characters of not only population, but also the factors that contribute in the areas of social, psychological, economic, health, and cultural factors, which are very important for us to understand the factors that are contributing for the changes in the vital events like fertility, mortality, migration are very important. And also, given the dynamics that takes place among these population characteristics, are furthermore is very important, because given the diversity, heterogeneity of population who are living in various geographical regions of the country like India, such understanding makes a lot of variations for us to know how best we can evolve suitable policies and schemes and programs for the benefit of these people, so that quality of life of all the people can be addressed and we can claim, or furthermore we can move progressively in bringing a developed country for India.